Hello everyone. So this is the title of the talk. JavaScript is mischievous. Handle the third party content with care. Okay. It sounds a little crazy, I know. Let's see what's about. Okay. So by the way, I'm Krishna Chaitanya and I work at Security and Privacy Research Lab at Mischievous Lab. I have my microphone can give you too. So how many of you have built mashup? 3, 4, 5 hands. Okay. Anyways, let's see what a mashup is first of all. As the definition says, it's a web application which combines content from multiple origins to create a new service. It's like you have a service A and you have a service B. You combine both the services and you create a new service. That's a mashup. Okay. We'll see the examples shortly. And then the integrating party is called the integrator. The party combining the content is called the integrator, whereas the integrated content is called a gadget. So have you heard about gadgets? Gadgets, you heard about it, right? And then what's the benefit of doing a mashup? It provides more value add than individual services. It's fun, it's easy to do it yourself, and then it's all about JS madness. Okay, here it's about. So have you seen any of these? Used any of these? I Google is very popular. That's housing maps. Here it's like the weather is from some other website or some other origin. And then the calendar is from some other origin, ports is from some other origin. You can plug everything and then you can create an application which gives you more value. Okay? So, yeah, this is the Hasgeek Facebook widget. So, anyone has embedded Facebook widgets in their web pages? Twitter widgets, and then did anyone try to embed ads in their pages? At least Google ads and all. So, if you have done any of these, you already created a mashup. So, it's not a new technology. If you have created any of these, you would have already created a mashup, okay? So mashup and security. So why should we talk about security? First of all, what are the approaches in which you can build a mashup? Okay, the whole day we have seen a lot of sessions which cover about JavaScript, maybe including JavaScript libraries, Ajax libraries, or maybe data visualizations and all these things. So what is the common thing in all these sessions? It's like you try to get a third-party JavaScript file and then embed in your web page, right? So, how do you build a mashup? Basically, one very good and very easy approach is to embed XML JavaScript in your file. Okay, just point a script tag to some other .js file. So, it could be a jQuery.js or some visualization.js or anything, right? So, the easiest way is to point to an XML JavaScript file. What's the other way? Loading content via iframes. So, you know what iframes are? HTML iframe tag, iframe src equal to you give the URL. So basically what an iframe does, when you give the src, it will try to load a content from a remote page and then embed in that particular page. Those are basically iframes. So that's a very basic tag in HTML. So interestingly, even iframes can be used to create mashups. If you go back and see this iGoogle, so this one gadget or widget, okay, and then this another widget. So you can visualize this as an iframe containing SRC equal to some other information, right? So you have a couple of iframes in this particular page. And then if you see the other page there, Google, it's about Google Maps and having some data on it. For example, let's say I'm a newcomer to Chennai and then I want to know all the petrol pumps near IIT Madras. Okay, so I can create an application like this where I have a Google Map API and then I put all the petrol pumps near, I query all the petrol pumps near IITM and then I can plot it on a Google Map. So there, how do I achieve it? I achieve it using JavaScript. So I embed XML JavaScript files in my web page and then I can create a product, a simple application like that. So you have iframes way of doing it, you have the JavaScript way of doing it. So there are basically two different ways of doing it. And then what are the requirements of any given mashup? It's like you need an interaction between the different components. In this particular case, let's say you have a calendar control here. If you change the date in the particular calendar, or if you select tomorrow's date, I would be happier if I can get the weather of tomorrow. Okay, that's what I mean by interaction. Okay, and then communication. So if you have different widgets, if they can communicate to each other, that would be really awesome. So that would be one of the major requirements of a mashup. And then security. So what are the problems related to security we see in mashups? Isolation of origins and secure data exchange. We'll invest well into these things a little bit later. So same origin policy. How many of you have heard about same origin policy? Okay, many, very good, awesome. At least I'm happy with this. More people have heard about SOP rather than mashups. Anyways, we'll come to the point. So what's same origin policy? Let's say you have two different domains. A script from one domain cannot access the DOM of another domain. That's basically what same origin policy defines, right? So browser has to isolate different origins. Otherwise, what will happen? I am a hacker. I create a evil gadget, and then with that evil gadget, I can steal the information of your complete web page. For example, I have a web page wherein I have advertisements. How does an advertisement come into web page? First of all, by some external JavaScript file, right? So I embed some maybe Google's advertisement JavaScript file or some other JS file. So when I embed the JS file, that JS file is having access to my entire DOM. So if you're able to read your Facebook friends list, even that JavaScript file can read your Facebook friends list, and it can export to some other domain, right? So how does browser differentiate between different origins is the main question. So there's a policy in browsers called same origin policy, which tries to does this task for us. Okay, by origin, what do I mean? It's scheme or protocol, :// host:port. Okay, that's a weird thing. It's as simple as this, http://bing.com. So HTTP or HTTPS, these are different schemes or protocols. And then bing.com, host and port number. Port by default is 80, and then there you can see 81. Okay, these examples are from, these are different examples of different origins. Okay, all the three are from different origins, you can see there. Now, if a script is in a different origin, what all privileges does it have? Let me put it in a simple way. You're saying script src equal to some jQuery.js. So what all privileges does this jQuery.js have? Or in fact, any other JS file in your web page have? It can have full network access, which means it can make AJAX calls, and then whatever a genuine form request what you are doing, the same thing the script can do, right? It can read and write access to the DOM. That's how jQuery and all the JavaScript libraries work. And then you can also store data. You can store data in DOM, maybe local storage or different mechanisms, cookies or whatever it is. So scripts of one origin cannot access DOM of another. That's the basic policy which is embedded in all the browsers. That's the reason why we are safe and secure, at least to some extent. But then even there are workarounds in which this can be violated. So there comes the actual problem. The problem of security comes at this particular place where an SOP is violated. But if you observe, strangely, scripts themselves are exempted from SOP. You can always create script src equal to google.com/something.js. You can always do that, right? So when scripts can't access DOM of another, they can still be loaded from a different origin. So somehow this sounds like a contradictory idea. In fact, you can see in many of Douglas Crockford's statements, you can see this is a common statement in many Crockford's videos. And then what else are eliminated or exempted from SOP? Any other guesses?
Images, resources.
Awesome, image. So image, SRC, you need not give to a genuine image. You can even give some JavaScript code and then that's how a type of XSS attacks are done, right? Image SRC equal to, you can create some, you can give some JavaScript code there. So even, yeah.
If scripts are exempted from SOP,
yeah.
Let's say I build an evil gadget, you include the JS file from my gadget. What I do is I replace that your script with my same copy from my domain.
Okay.
Wait, now I can access all the DOMs.
See, when scripts are exempted, what I mean is, see, let's say you're the developer, you can always say script src equal to, you can load it from your own domain.
Yes.
Right? You can host the site in wherever, whatever domain.com, whatever it is, but then that particular page can load the JavaScript file from your domain, isn't it?
Yeah.
The statement which I said here is exactly the same point.
No, that is not what I was asking. You have a JavaScript, you are creating some DOMs using your JavaScript.
Yes.
You load my JavaScript, I mean like you use my JavaScript for a plugin.
Okay.
Okay, what I do is, I delete your JavaScript and...
How do you delete?
You said that the DOMs are accessible, right? Script,
okay,
script DOMs.
Through your JavaScript you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay, fine. Yeah.
Through
okay.
My JavaScript, I delete your JavaScript.
Okay.
But I have a copy of the same JavaScript in my domain.
Okay.
I load that.
Okay.
So basically, there's no change.
Yes.
But I was able to access your domains, like your DOM elements.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. See, when I'm embedding your JavaScript, I'm trusting you, right?
Yeah. Okay.
Why should I trust you? That's the whole point of security there.
Okay. Right? That is what I was saying. So,
yeah,
SOP is not perfect, right?
No. See, it's like I'm trusting you and embedding your script. The script still loads from your server, but it executes under my context, under the user's context.
Okay.
Right? But see, as per SOP, even if it shouldn't even load from your server, if it applies to script. But it loads from your server, but executes in the browser's context.
Okay.
Right? It's as if...
So it create a cookie from a third-party script also, it will go in your domain, not the third-party domain.
Exactly. So it's executing in the context of the user who is using it. So essentially, script is nothing like... It's working the same thing as a user.
Okay.
Right? Yes. That's the whole point. Okay, good that you brought this earlier, because now at least the context can be set clear. So similar to script, images, even they do the same way. In fact, iframe src equal to, you can point it to some other domain. So all these are like violations of same origin policy. Okay, so coming back to the ways of building mashup, one approach we said is script based approach, right? Wherein we embed external JavaScript file into our web page and then we do some coding there. The benefit this one has is very good interactivity. For example, you can see on Google Map, you can plot some petrol pumps and then you can drag and drop all this. So the benefit is like, we can clearly see the benefit. It's very interactive. But the only problem is, as he rightly said, we are assuming that the script is from a trusted source. It need not be from a trusted source. Okay, I'll trust Google or I'll trust Yahoo or I'll trust all the big companies. But I don't know whom I should trust. If there's some guy who's saying, okay, my JavaScript library does this job for you, I'm trusting that, okay, that'll do, that's safe, and then I'm including it in my web page. But then it could be insecure or it could do all the malicious things like the guy just now said, right? And then no isolation of origin. Okay, let me cover these points. Embedded scripts have privileges of imported page, not the source server. So how many of you have tried something like open facebook.com, paste this script in the address bar, and then you'll be able to see who all visited your profiles? Did you see anything like this?
There are a lot of
paste
this. I think it was more popular in the Orkut days.
Exactly. I mean, still it's popular in the Facebook days also, but it's in a different way. It's like this some flash movie is playing. It's like, it looks like YouTube, but not exactly YouTube. So when you click on it, there's some JavaScript file which is copied into your clipboard. And then he'll say, put your cursor in the address bar, press J and press Ctrl V, and then hit enter. Basically, what he's trying to do is, he's making you copy and paste that malicious script in your address bar. So it's like a different way of doing it. So it's still popular, right? We do, I mean, at least out of innocence, we try to do such kind of things. So what happens is, it'll do all sort of different things, and then it'll say, on your wall, you'll see some things like, okay, this guy has bought a free Facebook t-shirt, why don't you try this? Or maybe, oh my god, how did she do all this in public? And these kind of things we generally see. So how does all that happen? It's because the embedded scripts have same privileges of the imported page, not the source server. So the scripts are originating from a malicious server, but then they're executing the browser's context, right? So that's a problem. That's the main problem of embedding scripts in your web page. Of course, they offer the very good benefits, but do you trust them? That's the important question you should ask. And the best example which we have is ads, widgets, Ajax libraries all have the same rights, right? So if you're using an Ajax library and doing some very good job, the other kind of scripts which are used by widgets as well as ads, they also can do the same good things or the same bad things. But do we ever care about this? Not sure, we don't care really. As long as our work gets done, okay, that's fine. Okay, so he's a guy, almost all the JavaScripters respect, Douglas Rockford, is the JavaScript architect at Yahoo. So these are quotes he himself said in most of the presentations. So these are really interesting. SOP prevents useful things, allows dangerous things. That's really interesting thing. So what useful things it prevents? Obviously, cross-origin Ajax calls would be useful, but then that's stopped. So that's a useful thing. Then dangerous things, allowing image and allowing scripts to load from other domains, that's a dangerous thing. And then, if there's a script from two or more sources, the application is not secure, period. So he says, it's obvious. So if you're having more than two JavaScript files, it's like your application is not secure. So whatever is the benefit you get, he says it's not secure, which is true. We know that it's not secure, or at least we don't care about the security part of it, but we try to get things done, right? Fundamentally, SSS is a confusion of interests. This is really interesting. So what is the confusion about? You know what SSS is, right? Cross-site scripting. So you have a text box, you don't sanitize the input. If I say script alert hi and then hit enter, boom, I can get that alert on my web page. That's basically a basic SSS example. So he says fundamentally SSS is a confusion of interests. I know that SSS is evil, cross-site scripting is evil, I don't want it in my page. But at the other end, I know mashups are useful and I create mashups by putting different JavaScript files on my page. So it's like, you guys are interested in this, you guys are interested in this. So it's a confusion of interest basically. That's what he tries to say. And then a mashup is a self-inflicted SSS attack. So all of us know that it's a SSS attack indirectly, but then we try to create mashups. That's what he tries to say. The point is, he doesn't say that mashups are bad. He says mashups are the things which change the entire web platform, the change which was not seen in 20 years, mashups brought a change. That's what he says. But the point is, it's being done by a language which has several bad parts. as well as developers who don't have complete idea of the security concept of it. That's what it tries to say. I think all of us respect in this, all these points, right? Obviously we can't negotiate, or I mean we can't say no to this, because he's a master and whatever he is saying is, I think, is very much perfect. Then script isolation. So if you have seen Facebook, we try to enter different types of comments and all, or if you have ever tried to inject a script tag into it, ever tried to hack Facebook, insert script elements into it, whatever, have you ever tried that? We try to keep all the good comments, but even if you try to insert a script tag and say alert hi or whatever it is, you still get it as script only. Like you not actually see script executing inside Facebook. Why? Because Facebook is doing something very good, right? So he says, okay, sorry. So script isolation is, now that we know JavaScript doesn't have any isolation of origins, there should be some way in which one origin has to be protected, should not attack another origin, and script should isolate each other. So how do we do that? Restricting JavaScript to a subset. So what is a subset? So it is like agreeing that JavaScript has certain bad parts. We create a subset of JavaScript which does not have all the evil features. Okay, that's like trying to say restricting JavaScript to a subset. So how do you do that? There's something called object capability security model. I know it's a very super techy term. So the idea is very simple. Let's say, okay, if an object in JavaScript has no reference to XML HTTP request, an AJAX call cannot be made. For example, you have, you can say where obj equal to new image. When you are not able to create new image, you can't access anything related to that image. So that's like trying to say, if we can build a language using this object capability security model, it does not have all the features of what actual JavaScript has. That's what this particular thing says. So what are the popular JavaScript subsets? Google Kaha, it's pronounced as Kaha, C-A-J-A, it's very popular. And then FPJS, Facebook JavaScript, and then AdSafe. So these are the different JavaScript subsets which are available. So what do these basically do? They try to rewrite. So whatever JavaScript you write initially as a developer, maybe create, do an AJAX request, get some data, manipulate it, put it into your DOM, you do all sort of things. But then what do these JavaScript subsets, what do they do? They have a compiler which will translate your entire code into a safe subset of JavaScript in which you don't have access to objects like this, okay? You don't have access to this or object, you don't have access to such kind of things. But why didn't these JavaScript subsets click very well as compared to the other parts of it? Because of the learning curve and usability issues. In fact, even the JavaScript compilers, even they are like evolving, and then I think as the compilers for Kaha and all become more user friendly, I think this option is like a very good way of creating new subsets.
Yes. So what do these compilers do? They take your JavaScript and verify that you're not, for example, using XML HTTP request, and they throw an error if you use that or something like that.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like they take your entire JavaScript, they do complete rewriting, they do static analysis, and then they do complete rewriting of the JavaScript so that you don't have access to basic objects like XML HTTP.
It does couple of things. It also does some level of sandboxing also. So make sure you're not polluting the globals and all. So essentially, rewrites a lot of stuff.
It's a development time thing, though.
Yeah.
Right. Not it.
No. So it's kind of both. So it's like you can also take third-party modules. At least the ones I know, Kaha and AdSafe. They kind of try to rewrite your code even for third party.
Okay.
They try to, if there are errors, it throws the errors.
Okay. So if you're looking for script isolation, ideally when you are including JavaScript files in your page, and you know that there's a possibility of attack. Ideally, you should have done this script isolation by using this JavaScript subsets, but we never care for this. That's a different query altogether. And then isolation with frames. Okay, we have seen that one type of mashup can be created using JavaScript, whereas the other type of mashups like iGoogle, you can create by frames, right? Each widget or gadget is like an iframe, and then they can talk to each other and then exchange data and all these things. So the benefit of using frames is you have a well-defined separate security context for each origin. Like each iframe is like a different sandbox, and then one frame, the script in one frame cannot talk to script in another frame. So by this we can say that frames comply with same origin policy. For example, you can see the snippet here. If you can say SRC equal to whatever page in the same domain, okay, and then in JavaScript you can say frames of 0 or content document or body, which means you are trying to access the content of that particular frame. If it is from the same domain, it is allowed. If it is from a different domain, http://crossdomain.com. The same code will not allow. You'll get an error. You'll get security error. So that's because of our same origin policy. So one good point with the frames which we have seen is they comply with SOP and they can clearly separate different origins. Whereas JavaScript can't separate different origins. That's the main difference we have here. But then frames also have one particular problem. This is slightly misunderstood and requires a little in-depth understanding. Frames can also be navigated to different origins. Frame navigation is not the same as same origin policy. Now I think many developers get mistaken in this second point here. Frame navigation is not the same as same origin policy. It's like you have iframe src equal to some URL here, right? You can't read the src using some remote script. You can't read this src attribute because that's a same origin policy restriction. But what you can do is you can always redirect that src to something else. Okay, this is not a part of same origin policy. This is something defined as frame navigation policy. Okay, this is like implemented in all the browsers, but this is not officially documented anywhere. This is a research conducted by Stanford Security Research Lab, and then they published a research paper which is there in the references. So you can see that. So they call this frame navigation policies. In fact, all the browsers follow this. Now that we know frames separate different origins and also frames navigate each other, what all can we say? Can script in frame A modify the DOM of frame B? Is this possible? Yeah, if they are from different domains, it's not possible because of same origin policy. But can script in frame A navigate frame B?
Yes,
you can always do that. So this is not same origin policy. Remember this point. The next set of slides are based on this particular point. So are you clear with this? Fine. Cross window attack. So this is possible. I think in maybe IE7 was just released or something like that. In fact, it's possible in all browsers. Since I don't have any screenshot or something, I directly took it from the Stanford Security people's PPT. So it's like you have an advertisement here, and then you have a login form there, right? Now, if this entire thing is developed in JavaScript, what can this advertisement do? As you type the email ID and password, you can directly look into the DOM and you can get your details, right? So a good idea is to embed or include that entire login form in an iframe. What's the point here? If this particular login field is in a iframe, then this script cannot talk inside into it can't access the DOM of the iframe. That should be a secure case.
But how will that be secure? Because the ad has been loaded with script from a different domain. That's the idea, right?
Yes.
But that script is still running in the same context as this page. And that iframe, okay, so you're saying the iframe should be loaded from some domain other than
subdomain.
Google.com. Okay. Subdomains. Okay.
You have to change the domain in the iframe.
Sorry?
That iframe must be a different domain.
Different domain.
Yeah, subdomain should be fine. Okay. Unless you have domain relaxation and things like that. Subdomain should be fine.
Okay.
But the problem here is, since frame navigation is possible, this ad can navigate this frame to a different frame. Right? Now this is like a phishing. Typical case of phishing, this is called frame phishing. Now in this case, what you can do, what this guy does is, he redirects that to an attacker's page, and then whenever you enter your credentials, you are actually entering the credentials in an attacker's page. Okay? There will not be any redirection, no history button, nothing, everything will be the same. Because it's only a frame redirection there. So this is called cross window attack. This was due to some question. Okay. This is due to some wrongly implemented policy in the browser. Okay. After these set of attacks, okay, this was finally patched in, I think it's patched long ago. Okay, now this doesn't work if you are trying to do this in the same thing. Okay, this is already patched. But later on, another type of attacks came. So when gadgets were first developed, like for example, iGoogle, you have different gadgets here. And then this is an evil gadget. Now he can write some script, and then he can navigate all the gadgets to evil gadgets. Now this is again dangerous. Yes, sir.
This is a previous example. How was it patched? I mean, because the policy still allows that, right?
I'm aware of the point. There are a couple of slides there. Say, sir. Okay, so these were the set of. Sorry? Yeah. So this is cross window attack. This is possible because of one wrong policy in the browser. This is patched. Again, this after that patch, a new type of attacks came, same window attacks, wherein one gadget can redirect the frames of other gadgets. Now this also patched. So what's the actual problem? So they seem to be some problem other than same origin policy, right? So am I fine till here? Able to follow till here? Fast, slow, okay? question?
You said in same origin policy, something can't access other domains, DOM elements, right?
Script of one domain can't access the script of another DOM.
Other domain, okay. So this evil gadget is one domain and the other gadgets are other domains.
Right.
Iframe is Google domain.
Okay.
So how can evil gadget access Google domain's DOM?
That's what, you're not accessing the DOM. So if I'm able to access the content inside this.
Okay, you're just navigating.
I'm just navigating it.
Okay.
Okay, if I'm able to say, if I'm able to read this gadget dot element or do something, then that's variation of same origin policy.
I thought the element dot source is also reading kind of thing.
So only that we are navigating this to an evil gadget.
Okay.
So in fact this is even more dangerous, right? I have control on complete gadget.
Yes.
So you can create some fake login forms or whatever and you can steal your data. Right?
Even to navigate, can I navigate from other domain for iframe? Let's say I have an iframe list from some other domain,
okay,
and I have frame more iframe from some other, like the same thing.
Okay.
Like I can navigate the other's iframe from a different domain iframe. What you are saying it now?
Yeah. This was possible previously. Now it's not possible. This is possible previously. See, all these gadgets are from different domains.
Okay.
Okay. Now this guy can navigate any other guy irrespective of the domain.
He can't even able to access that iframe, right? From the other domain. How could he change the navigation? When it says that iframe of 0, it will throw error, right?
No, he can access the parent, right? Top dot, he can access.
Okay.
When he says top dot, he'll get all the elements inside the top domain, which is the parent, right? Now he has access to the parent. Now he's saying parent dot iframes of 0, iframes of 1 or whatever. Right?
But you just...
Is it possible?
So,
it was possible.
Top is always accessible even if you're from a different domain?
Yes.
Not all the properties, but some properties of it, yes.
Oh, some properties.
Like location can be accessed.
Okay. SRC, the entire concept of navigation is based on that, right? So we are, hope you are clear on this. So we are not accessing the content inside this, we are only navigating this. It is possible because he is accessing his top, in the top dot frame dot location or whatever it is, right? So what are the real culprits? So here is the main culprit. There is a policy called permissive policy. What it says is, okay, imagine this outer box is a browser window, okay? And imagine the inner box as a iframe. And this arrow means this fellow can navigate this fellow. Okay? So read it in this particular way. So if you see the last one, you have two different windows. Okay? And then the second window has an iframe. Now this window can navigate the iframe of this. This is cross-window attack. This is what we have seen
but
in the first.
You need to have a window handle first, right? I mean, unless you open the window, how do you get a handle of the window?
Alright, window.open, simple public.
So only those windows.
Right.
Okay.
Did not only the window.open, I guess.
I mean, that's the only way you can get a handle of a window, right?
Otherwise, we cannot get a handle to the
opening browser contest. I think, that's the only case. At least I can think
if a browser gives you a way of getting the handle to other windows, that will be rather scary.
Yes, of course.
You can just open the window that will have the Gmail and read all the content out of it. Or something like that.
That's not possible.
At least I haven't tried, because at least I never had access, because it's like in old browsers. I can't even
only window.open, I think it's only window.open, I guess. Yeah.
Because it's like opening browser contest, so that shouldn't be the only way. So let's say this guy opened this window is opened by this guy. Even that is sufficient, right? An advertisement here to navigate this iframe, that's even dangerous, right? So this is cross window attack, which we have seen, now this is patched. Now this is a window having two iframes. This iframe can navigate this iframe. This is the same window attack which we have seen just now. Now these are like two different scenarios. In this scenario, this is the browser window, this is an iframe, this is another iframe. So it's like nested iframes, descendants. Now this parent can navigate child 1 as well as child 2. Okay, this is another case. And in this case, you have only an immediate child, you don't have a descendant below the child. Right, only one child here. So this is called permissive policy, which means a frame navigation in any of this case is possible. Okay.
So a quick question, Krishna. Yes. So let's say I am an ad network and I have my ads on my website and there are ads for other ad networks also. Can I just migrate all the other people's iframes to my domain? Serve my ads on their iframes. Is it possible? Now, I mean,
no,
of
right
course.
Now it's not possible.
They fixed it all.
No, this is existing in something like.
That'd be really cool, right? I can run my ad network in a much better way
than. In fact, many people have become millionaires with this idea during the days of, IFF2 and all these things, okay? This is fixed in all the browsers right now. So next is the window policy, which doesn't, because cross window attacks is possible, they eliminated this off and then they had only these three things in place. So this is the window policy. This was existent till some phase, but again they said since same window attacks is possible, they will knock out this one. this is the descendant policy. So you don't have the last two ones here. You don't have cross window thing and the same window attacks here. This is the descendant policy. All the browsers right now implement descendant policy. Even HTML5 specs state this particular descendant policy to be followed. Like, let's say a new browser vendor is coming up, you should follow this policy. That's what the W3C says, right? There's also something called child policy. It even doesn't allow the descendant navigation. But there's a problem here. If you don't allow descendant navigation, it'll be like too strict. Almost all the communication in the web will be breaking here. Right? So they said, okay, let's maintain compatibility, let's not be too strict, and let's follow descendant policy. So that's what
let you finish.
Yeah. So that's what. So all the browsers as well as HTML5 specs, they define descendant policy to be followed. One more thing, nothing is in the hands of developers, all this is in the hands of browser vendors. Right? Yes.
What is the use case for the descendant policy?
Use case for the descendant policy.
As in the second part, you said that the child policy
is fine. You are asking about this one?
Yes.
It's difficult actually.
I'm guessing
embedded. I can think in the terms of an attacker.
Fair. I just meant, I didn't understand why they did not just go to the just the same child, just the immediate child policy.
Actually, there's, okay, to explain this particular thing, there's a concept called subspace. Okay, so before HTML5 Postgres came, IBM came about with Smash. They came up with a tool called Smash. It's a product. Okay, so what that does is, let's say you have content from two different domains, and then you need to exchange data between domains. There's no genuine way of doing it. So what it is, let's say we have two different iframes. Let us introduce a different iframe. Okay, this is from Facebook.com. This is from a subdomain of Facebook. Now you can relax. There's something called domain relaxation. You can relax that subdomain, and then you can exchange data between these two. Now this becomes your data object. Using similar thing, let's say you're having a partner. You can have partner.facebook.com. That is this one. Again, you can do domain relaxation, and you can exchange data between these two. Okay. What is the point? So it's like a broker where this guy is trying to convey data from here to here. Okay, that's one use case which was used in, I think, IBM's product. So other than that, I can't see any genuine use case where this will be used. But then, in fact, my demo is exactly based on this particular point, which I'm going to show if time comes.
Yes.
Yeah.
5 minutes.
Also. So many things to cover. Okay, quickly. So fragment identifier messaging. So all of us know this. We use something called hash message. Okay, we use this for communication, right? So previously, how do two different frames communicate? It's like, if I can have the hash and the data, I can access this data and I can pass to the other way. So previously, before HTML5 post message came, this was the way in which two different frames communicate with each other. But then once HTML5 came, we have a lot of good things. For example, we have this post message API. Using post message API, you can post data of one iframe to another iframe securely.
Could the window.name hack could be used for transferring data across? If you have a frame, can you say that frame window or content window.name equal to the data? That would also work, right, for transferring information across.
In fact, that used to be one of the ways.
You won't get an event like hash change on it, but you can use it for transferring information across.
That. In fact, there's also this resize event. People try to resize. When you resize a window, a resize event will be fired. Even using that, we can exchange data. Okay. So all these are different hacks, but then not so popular. Because the amount of data which you interchange is like very less.
Very less, yeah.
So post message, using this, you can exchange in fact a lot of data. Right? So now you have this thing called trust, you know, to whom you are actually sending the message. For example, in post message, you have other people post message, a message and a target origin. So you can say whatever message here it is, then you can have your target origin here, like this. Hello partner and then the URL. So this is secure because you know to whom you are transferring this particular message, right? And then there's no limit on data and all. Then you have this on message event handler, wherein you can listen to the message and then you can reply to other stuff. Apart from this, you also have this sandbox and CORS specifications in HTML5. So what does this sandbox thing do? It takes a whitelisting approach. For example, when you say iframe sandbox, it will not allow scripts, form submissions, pop-ups. It will not do all this. It will not allow all these kind of things. So it's a whitelisting approach wherein if say you want scripts, you need to say sandbox allow scripts.
So what's the current browser support of sandbox and course?
I'm not pretty sure about the versions. IE10 has, with respect to IE10 has support for these. Chrome existing version supports all of these. In fact, Chrome is the first one to support, I think, this one. Firefox, I'm not serious about it. And then, okay, so we have Ajax here, we have site A and the server of site A, site B, server of site B. Now this is, this blue communication is Ajax, from a browser to the server of the same site, right? Now this client side communication, this is cross post message or cross domain communication on the client. Now this this one is the CORS specification. But one problem, see, the frames have, now if you frame an application, you have all very good benefits, but only problem is framing attacks, wherein this clickjacking is there. You know, you heard about clickjacking, so this is a dangerous way in which your clicks can be stolen. In fact, all your Facebook spams are due to this clickjacking stuff only. And then this frame phishing attack, we have seen the descendant policy there. Based on that, I created a small demo. I'll show the demo right now. So those are references. And then I show the interview. Have you had
him? Yeah.
2 minutes. Yeah.
We have 2 minutes.
Okay, so this is the partner website. Okay. So this is my partner's website. It's hosted on port number 81. So this is a different domain from my actual website. Okay. So my actual doesn't have anything. Just as a partner website. This is my actual website. Okay. Now I want to communicate with a partner. So how do? I just embed an iframe, and then I use post message communication. The same thing which I have shown in the previous snippet. So if I say hello partner, or you can directly communicate using this HTML post message API. Fine. Now coming back to the descendant policy which I have said, wherein you have nested frames approach. You have the nested frames approach. Now this is the same site. This is my actual site and this is my partner. Okay. Now what I have done here is, I have wrapped the entire site in an iframe. Okay. Now this is the, now see, this is actually an iframe here. You can see the border here. This is actually an iframe. This blue one is the actual site, but this one is the parent site. But since I am opening the entire thing in an attacker window, okay, now this attacker is redirecting this gadget to a new gadget. It's because of descendant policy. Now this guy is redirecting to this guy, right? Now you have an evil gadget here. So whatever you submit, actually the evil gadget can actually steal your data. So this is a problem with framing. And then, so clickjacking, let's say there's some site where you can vote up. I'm voting it up. Votes 1, 2, 3, whatever. And then I go to a feedback site. How is this session going on? Mind blowing. Then I submit. Okay. I come back. The votes got increased one by one. So how did this happen? Because there's a hidden button there. It's actually an iframe which is containing the other site, the previous site. So this is a simple clickjacking trick. Okay. So actually this is an iframe. This is containing the previous page completely. I positioned it such a way that the just vote up button is above this submit button. Similarly, you can also do in the JavaScript way. I click super like in this, and then I come back to my page and I refresh it. Words got increased. Now what happened here? Can you see this button here? Below my cursor?
You can completely hide it and nobody will notice.
Yeah, that's how clickjacking does.
Click, there is going to be a vote up.
Yeah, wherever I click, I'm just going to vote up your thing. Right? So I can increase my sessions.
This can be a Facebook like button also. So you can just get.
In fact, I have a demo. I don't want to show the code. In fact, I have a Facebook like button demo. Okay, I'll not show the code, but still. Okay, I can make you like my code or like my session. Okay, I don't have internet access. But then, if you can see the code of this, it actually has a like button here. When you click, it takes to Facebook. Okay. So these are the framing attacks which are there. So you should be careful of these framing attacks. Summing up quickly. If you are going to use JavaScript way of using mashups, you have to go for JavaScript subsets. If you are using iframes, you have to take care of all. You have to use all the HTML5 specifications and also take care of HTML5 the framing attacks. That's the secure way of doing mashups. So that's it.
Krishna, can I add something to this?
Sure, sure.
So the thing is, Krishna's talk is precisely about if you are a consumer of a third-party script or third-party library and all. and he precisely covers most of the most important points. But let's say if you are a producer of a third-party library and you want to write a third-party component that others can consume, there are a series of articles by one of our regular presenters, Rakesh. Just look up for Rakesh Pai third-party library. If you are building third-party widgets, go through that as well. He did that in Pune and Bangalore. He couldn't come to Chennai because of some personal work. But go through that. That'll be a really good compliment with this talk.
Yeah, 5 minutes extra.
Okay.
I've taken the stage.
Thanks, Krishna.